paper in the British Journal of Sports Medicine, published by Professor Roald Bahr, was entitled "Why Screening Tests to Predict Injury Do Not Work and Probably Never Will." So today we're going to explore the findings in that paper and discuss, well, maybe if they don't predict injury, why would we be using them? I'm Jo Clubb, sports scientist and founder of Global Performance Insights, a company providing sports science consultancy to sports teams, sports tech companies, and individuals and athletes all around the world. So today we're going to focus on Professor Bahr's paper. I'll put in the description below to the BJSM paper. He said that there were three steps to identify if a screening test can predict an outcome. They are conducting a prospective cohort study to identify risk factors as well as the cutoff value that we would use for our high risk and low risk groups. Next, we would validate this test and the cutoff values that we were using in multiple cohorts. And then thirdly, a randomized control trial to test the effect of an intervention group and a non-intervention group based on our earlier findings. When we're looking into whether tests can predict an outcome, there are some properties that we need to understand. Most importantly is sensitivity and specificity. These are measures of how well a test can identify whether someone has a disease or not. Traditionally, these approaches are used in terms of medicine in relation to predicting disease, and we are trying to apply that in our sports setting. So sensitivity is a test's ability to correctly identify people with a disease. So a highly sensitive test would have few false negatives, basically misses fewer cases of the disease. Whereas specificity is a test's ability to correctly identify people without a disease. So a highly specific test has few false positives. And these are actually inversely related. So as one increases, generally the other one decreases. It's very difficult to have a test that is both highly sensitive and specific. And often this is because test values for people both with and without disease can often overlap. And so a cutoff value may include people from either group. And that's going to be really critical in a moment when we look at this in relation to some sports screening data. So sensitivity and specificity is often displayed in a matrix such as this. Those who have the condition and are found positive is a true positive, that is correct. Whereas those who have the condition and found negative is a false negative. And cumulatively, that column tells us about sensitivity. Whereas if someone does not have the condition but is found positive, then that's a false positive. As opposed to someone that does not have the condition, the result comes back as negative, and that is a true negative. And those combine to give us our specificity. And I think I'll illustrate this with an example that we're probably all familiar with and use COVID-19 testing. So sensitivity for the rapid test for COVID-19, let's say it had an 80% sensitivity level. That means from 10 infected persons, those tests will come back with 80% accurate, 8 out of 10 accurately reported as true positive. Whereas 2 would report a false negative. It would say that they did not have the condition when they did. Conversely then, specificity. So with 90% specificity in this particular testing approach means that out of every 10 non-infected persons, 9 would result in a true negative. The test would confirm that they did not have the disease. On average, 1 false positive. 1 person out of 10 who did not have the disease reporting a positive test, even though in reality they did not have it. Okay, so now we understand those properties of sensitivity and specificity. Let's take a look at an example from sporting data. So this example is discussed by Professor Bahr in his paper, whereby he took data from another publication. In this case, it was knee abduction moments from female athletes in a previous publication by Tim Hewitt and colleagues. And they illustrated the data in this way. So we can see a somewhat normalized bell curve distribution, although somewhat skewed with quite a number of high results there. For these athletes, they were screened and then it was tracked over the course of the season as to who suffered an ACL injury and who did not. In this case, 9 athletes out of their population of 205 in total went on to have an ACL injury. So this discussion around where we would place our cutoff threshold for high risk and low risk for predicting future injury is well illustrated here, because if we were to set our cutoff threshold, for example, at point A, and anyone above that amount of knee abduction moment was identified as high risk, well, we can see that that would return a sensitivity of 44% and a specificity of 93%. So remember, sensitivity relates to those who go on to get injured. We're only capturing 44% of those. We can see the 4 black figures that illustrate those who went to get injured, but we have more than half of our injured athletes below that cutoff threshold. So that's why there is a low sensitivity. So perhaps we're thinking, well, let's reduce our cutoff value. Let's shift it back to a lower knee abduction moment. Yes, this increases our sensitivity to almost 90%. There's just one individual below that who is not captured then in our high risk group. However, our specificity has then dropped to 70% because we are capturing many more athletes who did not go on to suffer an ACL injury within our high risk group. This was demonstrated with a number of different examples, including this one that was from Nicole Van Dyke's study, quite a well-known study around hamstring injury risk, in this case with isokinetic dynamometry. And again, the key point here is this massive overlap between our athletes who go on to get injured and our athletes who do not. Now, of course, we wish it was clear cut. We wish we had these 2 separate groups where if you are above or below that number, that means you would get injury. But injury is complex. According to Bittencourt's paper, this web of determinants of different risk factors that are contributing differently to the outcome. They're also interacting with one another. So it's not as straightforward as just that one risk factor causes that injury, but they are all contributing, and the different impact of different risk factors can heighten an individual's injury risk. So a single factor alone, a single test, a single metric does not necessarily guarantee that if an athlete performs poorly or is below a particular risk cutoff value, that they are definitely going to get injured. We cannot use that single risk factor to predict injury. Now, of course, with the evolution in AI and machine learning techniques and similar approaches, then perhaps we are seeing developments in the way that big data and many different risk factors and information could be used to forecast injury risk, not necessarily predict and say that person will get injured. That, though, is a discussion for another day. Let's stay then thinking about our screening tests. And if we're not necessarily using them to say this person is going to get injured, then how might we use them? And there's a number of different papers that have suggested a number of different purposes for our screening tests. I definitely recommend reading this paper in the Aspitar Journal. Interestingly, this is authored by, again, Nicole Van Dyke, but also you see Roald Bahr on there as well as an author. Certainly, Professor Bahr is not saying don't do them. His paper is focused on the specific prediction on an individual level. And remember that this is also related to a perhaps more broad screening approach and the health evaluations that include all the medical screening as well. Slightly different perhaps to our ongoing screening measures that help give insight into neuromuscular fatigue and impairment that we've talked about in a number of our other videos. So the 3 purposes given in this paper are to detect current musculoskeletal conditions. It gives the medical staff a chance to assess players and see what they might have bubbling under the surface or perhaps not reported or occurred since they've been away in the off-season, as an example. Secondly, to establish performance baselines and healthy state performance. This, of course, is a key part of what we've been talking about in our athlete testing series of tracking where our athletes are at from a physical capacity perspective. And critically, screening can also be an opportunity to build that practitioner athlete relationship to build rapport and to hopefully gain buy-in to your program and your interventions. From a risk perspective, they emphasize thinking about it more on a group level basis. So I'll just read out a paragraph from that Aspitar article, because I think Van Dyke and their colleagues really nicely illustrate this with this passage. So this is talking about a fictional athlete called Johnny. And they say, although Johnny has decreased eccentric hamstring strength that is associated with an increased risk of injury, he might not have an injury, whereas someone with normal hamstring strength may have an injury. But since Johnny is part of the group and the risk of the whole group is increased by having decreased eccentric hamstring strength, it is worthwhile improving the hamstring strength of the whole squad, as some hamstring injuries will also occur in those with normal hamstring strength. Johnny might still have an injury, but we can improve his odds. So their approach is very much to emphasize the group level approach to screening and injury risk management, to understand that reduced hamstring strength in footballers, for example, is a risk factor. Therefore, we want to have exercises in place, interventions in place for our whole group of footballers to try to improve their hamstring strength, and hopefully that reduces the risk of injury. I personally do, however, think that there is a place for individualized risk management. From my experience working in the applied environment, we don't necessarily have the time, the resources. We don't want to put the burden on the athlete to just do interventions that hopefully cover all risk factors. So I really like this approach from Mark Rowe and his colleagues talking about an injury risk management framework. And this figure in which they talk about these three-tiered approaches. We have a group approach in which the same intervention is given to all athletes. So in that case, something like a warm-up, for instance, all athletes receive. Or perhaps we're talking then about our hamstring injury risk management program that perhaps in football players, soccer players, everyone receives that. We then have a cluster approach, and some people like to refer to this as mailboxing, just ways in which we kind of group our athletes together and give them different kinds of interventions. For example, in soccer, perhaps everyone is getting the hamstring interventions, but you know, we perhaps don't have time to give hamstring plus groin plus ankle plus shoulder, for example, for our goalkeepers. Perhaps we're grouping athletes, which might be done based on their screening results, into different groups. It might be based on their position. For instance, our goalkeepers are going to undergo our ASH testing for their shoulders, which is then going to lead to specific interventions for them, which then leads into our third level, which is this individualized approach, where perhaps for each individual may get specific add-ons to their program. This might be specific exercise that they do pre-training as part of their prehab, could be isometric exercises or a little ankle proprioception balance circuit. So I think when we are conducting our screening and collecting our tests and looking at injury history, this is a really nice framework for thinking about the interventions it leads to. Because of course, these tests that we are talking about in this series and the data that we're collecting are most valuable when they lead to interventions that ideally help our athletes. And so we can think about injury risk management on a group level, a cluster level, and at times an individualized approach, even though we know that we're not absolutely certain that those athletes would otherwise go on to injure that specific body part. So whilst data from a single metric or a single test does not necessarily predict injury on an individual level, and we will get overlap in results between those athletes who go on to get injured and those that don't, I still think that obviously there is so much value to testing our athletes and then to using the data to help identify what may be the most pertinent group level interventions, but also all our cluster and our individual interventions to try and make our interventions as most impactful as possible for our athletes. Thank you for watching. I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please hit like and subscribe so you don't miss out on another Sports Science Insights video coming soon. And I want to thank Roald Performance for sponsoring this video, along with all our other videos in the athlete testing series, which I'll link to below.